Hey folks, just introducing you to a new toy in the Uncaged team. We're out to do a bit of hunting this week, and we've picked up a Trail 2, one of the best thermal scopes from Pulsar, thanks to Glenn at Wolfeye. Now, what we've got, yes, is a top of the range thermal scope. This model's got the range finder on the side, which is pretty handy to determine how far the animal is away from you at night time. So one of the tricks with the thermal scopes, it all looks great, but really determining the length of that animal away so you can get a nice accurate shot. We've got the focus on up here, the reticule here. On the top, we've got some of the buttons there for the menus, and of course the battery on this side here. So she's mounted on a Sako 85 in a 30-06 caliber. So just out today doing some zeroing in it. Not an easy exercise, but not too bad an exercise either. The important thing you'll see is that we need to have something hot or warm on our target so we can identify that, because the end of the day, the thermal scope doesn't work during the day. We're out to see something hot at night. So by the way, we've something handy actually is, if you're interested in a different way to carry your ammo, just the old Irwin carpentry bag actually. Not sponsored or by Irwin yet, but obviously last name Mick Irwin, but very handy, very very tough and rugged, so we can put our ammo in there and our bits and pieces in the middle. So hope you enjoy having a look at the Pulsar Trail 2. We've also got a Pulsar monocular as well for the upcoming trip. So these both Wi-Fi to an iPad. So you're going to see, put it this way, if you've got someone in the back of a buggy or a ute with a monocular, whoever's driving or the passengers inside the ute can be looking at an iPad and sort of scanning really for some things with a bit of heat out there. So it just involves everyone actually, that ability to for these things to Wi-Fi to an iPad. So hope you enjoy. We're going to zero in this scope now, and then I hope you enjoy this next week of hunting out west, see what we can find. Okay, we've got the Trail 2 thermal scope here on trusty Sako 3006. We had our target down there about 80 metres. What we're trying to do is zero in the scope. So we'll have a shot and see where we're at. Let's go down and have a look and see if we hit it. Let's take the bolt. Yeah, and we'll go for a walk. After our first shot, 80 metres away, we walk down here and there's a hole in the target that we... And the issue is, no one believes anyone if that was my first shot or not, because Stuart, who's filming, he actually put the sign up, so we don't know if he's taking the piss out of me. And we've got friend Damien over here. He's the he's my assistant out hunting. No, he's not. He's a good mate from hunting. He doesn't believe any of us about the hole in there, so we're going to have to go back and have another shot and see where we hit. Or if we didn't hit. Okay, we're here again for our second shot. No one believes we just hit the target on the first shot, but the second shot will tell. We'll see how close we are.
Oh, I'm struggling to see. I'm actually struggling to see the sign this time. Okay, firing.
Let's go and have a look.
Just had two shots. Second shots just came in to the south a little bit to the right. So the issue I just had then is the first shot in the target, which we determined was an absolute fluke, but was also showing that the thermal scope was shooting reasonably well straight out of the box and straight on the top of the Sako 3006 with a Contessa rail on it. So we fluked at the first shot anyway, but it means we're on target. So the issue now, the shade's just come over and there's really not a lot of heat coming out of this sign here. So I'm only seeing a really rough surround of this. So what we're going to do is heat a bit of aluminium up and we'll bring that down here and we'll have a shot at that. So there's a couple of different ways we can do this. If we had a bit of aluminium or a Coke can or something like that and it was the sun was shining, it'd put out a little bit of a different heat, so we might pick it up in the thermoscope. But just because of the time of day, we're running out of time, so we'll use a bit of aluminium here and obviously this gas will try and create a little bit of a hot spot on this aluminium plate, and hopefully we'll see that through the thermal. We're far enough away, we're about 80 metres away, so and we're comfortable that we're not going to get a ricochet off this. I'm still pretty impressed with the first shot right here, almost exactly in the centre of the target there. So I think we'll be talking about that at the pub for quite some time. My friend Damien has just left. We're very competitive out hunting there, so that's why he didn't believe. He was here, he witnessed it, but he thought we'd put that hole in the target prior to, so that's what baits are for. Nice and competitive. Rightio, we'll go back and we'll see if we can see a heat spot on that.
Righto, that seems to be working quite nicely down there. I've got a nice little heat spot on that piece of aluminium. So we'll show you in a minute because the Trail 2 has got an inbuilt recorder. So we'll get some good footage of this action as well. Okay, firing. Okay, let's go down and have a look at the third shot. See how we go. Yeah, righto, we've used this target with a heat dot. There is a small ding right there. So it is a 3006. I'm not too sure what a 3006 does to about a 4mm plate from 80 metres away, but we could definitely see a white heat area there from heating that up. So I think we'll try and find something else other than this plate to see if we can punch some holes in maybe a piece of aluminium that we can, something different that we can punch a hole in anyway.
Okay, a couple of different options there. We'll have two more shots.
Okay, we're on our fourth and fifth shot here. So the fourth one, we've got a some duct tape down there. We've just heated up the duct tape, stuff stuck to the core flute down there. And the fifth one, we've just found a little bit of aluminium and we've just put that on the core flute as well. So let's see how we go. Okay, let's go down and have a look, see how we went. Okay, our fourth shot, just to the right here, probably about 80 mil from the centre, so vertical's all right, but just shooting about there to the, and to the right. And then here's another piece we heated up, this bit of aluminium, and we're about 60 or so mil to the right there. Good thing to note is where we've placed this target today, we're confident there's nothing behind us. There's a bit of a hill behind us, so the bullets we're firing, you know, are just going to go literally 10 metres behind us through this board. So safety is the primary thing here today, so as well as trying to shoot straight. So pretty good. Let's try and adjust that thermal just to the left a little bit, I think. Okay, folks, we're just going to sight in the Marlin 4570. Just to show you, we've got the 4570 pill there versus the 3006, which is what we were firing just recently, and then also a 223, just to see the a difference in calibre there. So, but let's have a crack at the 4570. Use this for the pigs out there. Just a different type of weapon, really. A bit of fun. Got the Bushnell red dot there. But yeah, let's sight him in, or check him anyway to see how it is shooting. Okay.
Okay, firing.
Now that gives you a fair old jolt in the shoulder, so a bit more than the 3006. So let's go and have a look and see how we went. Okay, here's the result of the 4570. We had three shots, two quite close here, one a little bit further down. So what we need to do is move that little cluster there back down to here. So we might whack them down sort of about that, 100 to 150 mil. Down to here, we were about 80 metres away. So for the 4570, obviously not quite as accurate as some of the other weapons over a long distance, and with the bullets a little bit slower too. So but yeah, we just got to take into account the velocity of the 4570 pill. So this 80 metres is probably about the distance we shoot that over. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring the sight down about 120 mil to get us a little bit closer to our point there that we're trying to hit. Check this out, a tea tree behind the target here. I actually like my trees and just picked that. That's the 4570, just ripping that tree to bits. So sorry, tree. I hope you'll recover from that, but shows the damage that the 4570 is capable of anyway. Okay, guys, we're just going to see how the Adler 5-shot lever action is going to go. So we've got the target down there. I'm going to use the buckshot, which is 12 gauge and 9 pellets in each one of these. So, I explain things as equivalent, about 9 sort of 223, 243 pellets in each one of those, so not too bad for shooting pigs. So I'm just going to check my choke in there, and we'll go shoot the target and just check the spread of these things over a couple of distances. Let's go and have a look. Okay, here we are down at the target. We've got the Adler 5-shot and the SGs. So we'll throw a couple of these in. Great weapon for chasing pigs in some long grass or lignum or something like that, mainly up close. So let's see how we go. Firing. Firing. Okay, let's go up and have a look where they went. Yeah, here's all the little shotgun pellets basically spread out around the target. This is where it's just a couple of pellets have gone in the same spot and ripped the core flute. So that's only about 12 metres back or something like that. So let's go back a little bit further and just see what the spread looks like. Firing. Righto, you can come, let's go back down here. And you can see by this target going further back that the pattern's just got wider. So yeah, before we were sort of in here, so we've gone from about 10 metres back to 15 metres, and our pattern gets wider. So just gives a good indication that if that's a pig, at what distance away, and that we're going to still get one of these on that pig. So yeah, the Adlers are not a bad weapon actually. With that SG9 pellets, does a fairly good job in those conditions that I just spoke about before, with the long grass or slightly in the bush or something where you just haven't got time to get your head up and look through a scope. So a lot quicker with these things. Quick chat about feral animals in Australia. Really important that the hunters get an opportunity to eradicate feral animals in Australia for the farmers, but not only for the farmers, in the national parks. Many of you may not know, but the wild pig doesn't have a lot of predators. The boar can take out a dozen baby lambs in a night. They come in and they hit them with no protection from their mother. And they just take their liver and kidneys and leave them there. So there is actually no predator for the wild boar except the hunter and maybe a crocodile up north. So yeah, very important. There's millions of these things in Australia, and they breed really well, as in they can have 10 in a litter, and they can have easily 3 litters in a year. So makes for a lot of pigs. So also when we're out there The wild cat is unbelievably a predator that we need to get rid of, because those things can climb the trees, obviously, and really eradicate our native bird life. So while many of you may be cat lovers, it's really important that, and many if you cat lovers know that they breed really easily as well. So really important that we help eradicate those feral cats out there, and they grow quite large and can be quite dangerous as well. One of the other predators is a fox also that breeds well, is in a lot, and they take out a lot of our natural wildlife as well. So they're mainly the species that we're chasing out there, is the pig, the fox and the feral cat. There's one more actually that's actually becoming a really big problem out in the bush for the farmers, is the wild dogs. Now these things are really smart. They can also take down the lamb, and packs of dogs can take down a calf. So yeah, these things are fast. They're hard to hunt. The thermal stuff that we've just picked up is going to help us with the feral dogs out there. And yeah, just probably doing our bit, and so are all the majority of the other hunters out there. We're all SSAA, or many of us are SSAA members. That means we're registered hunters. Get out there. We go out onto properties who have asked us to come out to help eradicate some of those feral animals on their properties, and help. At the end of the day, these farmers are out there growing food for the rest of us citizens in the city or in other areas. It's heartbreaking when we go out to these properties, the farmers have asked us to come out, but to see a baby lamb or a number of baby lambs being killed by a wild boar is very disturbing, to say the least. to have a look at their crops that have been decimated by a mob of pigs is also, look, it's heartbreaking for us, let alone these guys who are out there struggling, as many of you know, over droughts and just the constant hardships out there being farmers. It must be really tough for those guys to see their crops get decimated by these feral animals. Hope you guys have enjoyed the zero in of the Pulsar Trail 2 today. As you can see, I've got the weapon here with no ammo in it and the bolts taken out. So all good. The Sako 85 in the 30-06 and the Pulsar Trail 2. Let's see what it can do out in the real paddock. Mate, the first impressions of this thing is an absolute weapon. Not the 30-06, but the Trail 2. It's one of the top of range thermal scopes out there. The range finder is going to be awesome, and the power of this thing is incredible. So look forward to using it out in the field in this coming week.